Hallelujah. We're asking the Lord to take the stage. Come on, y'all.
Take the stage, Lord, and have your way. I'm just a vessel.
Stage, oh God.
Dear Heavenly Father, here we are once again coming to you. God, I'm coming right now in the precious name of Jesus, thanking you, God, for another chance to come to you, oh God, asking you, Lord, to look beyond all of my faults and see the needs. Forgive me of all of my sins. Ask you now, Lord, to look down upon all of this nation. Look down right now, God, in the precious name of Jesus. Somebody needs you right now. Somebody going through a situation. Somebody needs you in their home. Someone needs you, oh God, in a hospital. Somebody needs you on a driveway. God, we ask you now that you would come in and touch somebody right now. Deliver somebody. Set them free in the name of Jesus. We understand, God, that you had said in your word that we would just come together and acknowledge you in all of our ways, then you would direct our path. We ask you, God, to grab our children by the hands and bring them together, God, in the schools. Bring our policemen together, God. Let them come and realize that this nation needs, oh God, you on their side. God, we thank you today. We thank you for everything that you have done. We thank you, God, because you have been our God. We thank you, God, that you're going to be, oh God, in the way when we need you to. Oh God, we said in your word that we would only look unto you, that you would do all the things that we need in our life. I come today, God, thanking you for where you brought me. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're getting ready to to do. Now, I pray right now, God, in the name of Jesus, that you set us free from all of our boundaries. Somebody's bound, somebody down in need right now. So, God, I ask you right now to lay hands on someone, change their mind. That sinner man, I ask you to go, God, and touch him today. Bring him and let him know that salvation is free in the name of Jesus. We thank you, God, for where you brought us. We thank you, God, for where you're taking us. Some child needs you. Some mother needs you. Some man needs you. In the name of Jesus, bless us all. Keep us all. In the name of Jesus, that hospital, that doctor, would you touch him right now? In the name of Jesus, that drive-by shooting, would you change them right now, Jesus? We need you. We need you right now. We need you. We need you right now. Would you do it for us? You said you would. In your word you send. Whatever we need, asking it shall be given. Somebody been weeping. Somebody been crying. But I know, God, you are way maker. And I'm praying right now that you make a way for them. Weeping men do for a night, but joy comes in the morning. We thank you, Lord. We just thank you for getting up. We thank you for even lying down. We thank you for our families. We thank you for our nation. We just thank you, God, for all you're doing. We ask you, Lord, to hear our prayer in the name of Jesus. This is my prayer to you, Jesus. I love you today. I praise you today. Thank you, God, for all you're doing. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You tuned in to the Gospel Joy with DJ T. Rowling.
I want to welcome each and every one of you this morning. Good morning to you. Good morning to your family. Thank you so very much for joining me. We want to say good morning to Facebook. We want to say good morning to the Gospel Live Lounge. Good morning to you. Those are on the app this morning. Those who are on TuneIn Radio, God bless you. Twitch, God bless you. Good morning to you, family. And listen, man, those who are listening all over the world, whatever means you're listening this morning, we pray that God will bless you. God will touch you. God will change your situation. And you will be empowered this morning. Kevin Downswell, if it's not you, then Lord, it's nothing.
I'm running. Won't stop till I touch you. You're my destination. Lord, you're all.
Glory to God, we bless your name, Jesus.
I said I won't stop. If it's not you, then Lord, it's nothing. If it's not you,
at 10 o'clock, we're going to have church matches with my good friend, Pastor Gifton. Pastor Gifton is going to be on here this morning with church matches. You don't want to miss this, y'all. Each and every Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock, Pastor Gifton come with church matches. Don't miss this. Don't you miss this. The bishop is ready. The bishop is charged.
Set me free.
Father God, if it's not you, then it's nothing. Well, I say good morning to Minister Carl Brown. Reverend, what's going on, man?
My heart's yours, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It's all I got.
If it's not you.
If it's not you.
Then Lord, it's nothing.
Then Lord, it's nothing.
It's nothing. It's no one. It's nothing. Come on.
If it's not you.
God, I want to say good morning to Jordan Gardner. Good night, good morning to you, Linda Zapp Cooper. Good morning. I want to say hello to Evangelist Watt, Kamala to Joseph Bailey, Marlene Williams Thompson, Trivine. Good morning to you, Joanne. Good morning. Sean Winter, good morning to you. Lady D. Gomez, good morning. Good morning. Kevin Downswell, if it's not you. We got about 10 more minutes to go before we hear from the man of God this morning. Just about 10 minutes to go before we hear from the man of God. If it's not you, Jesus, then Lord, it is nothing. Kevin Downswell coming to you this morning. Thank you, Lord.
Won't stop till I find.
Tomorrow, Francisca, good morning to you, and God bless you. Nevia Hall, I see you. God bless you. Welcome, welcome.
Come against you.
All right, Minister Judith Gale. What a worship this morning. Minister Judith Gale is going to take us to another level with Jehovah God. Judith Gale, y'all.
Gospel Joy with DJ D. Rohan. Gospel Live.
365 radio. We praise you now, Jehovah God.
We praise you now,
Jehovah God.
Hallelujah.
We praise.
Shout out to Lamont Jones. Good morning to you, Lamont. What's going on, Monty? Thank you for tuning in this morning. Marlene Williams Thompson, I see you. Blessings to you. All those who are listening on our website, God bless you this morning. Hallelujah.
Jehovah.
morning, girls, so to fix your face. Say, Angie Collier, good morning to you. Amanda Baxter, I see you. God bless you. Hugo Del Rosario, good morning, sir. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Come on, church. Somebody, let's worship him. He's worthy. Your banner over me, oh God. Jimmy Gale. Say you heard it right here on Gospel Live 365, the home of the best Caribbean American gospel radio. We are pointing souls to Christ. In just a few more moments, we're going to be here from the man, hearing from the man of God, our very own Pastor Gifton Wallace. He's back in Jamaica. So he's back in his own, on his own land, his own country. And we're going to hear from him this morning. And I know, I'm praying that the man of God will be anointed this morning. He's appointed this morning. And God is going to use him mightily this morning to talk to us about church matters, y'all. Yes. He got his home cooking. He's going home cooking. So he's well ready. He's well ready and charged up. Uh-huh. Well rested and charged up this morning. My God.
It's the morning show.
It's the morning show.
Gospel Joy with DJ
Roy. Hallelujah. And here's my good friend Don Martin, singing a song called, I Will Worship You, O God. I will worship you, O God. Indeed, I will. Remember, 10 o'clock, we're going to hear from the man of God. Right after this song, I want to say good morning to Roxana Snake, who's on her cruise, and she's checking in. Good morning, Roxana Nicole.
Lord, you are more beautiful.
And Maisie Jones, good morning, Maisie. Good morning to Juliet. Good morning, Juliet. God bless you. Thank you for joining us this morning. Uh-huh. Now listen to Don Martin. Don Martin out of Jamaica. I will worship you, O God. We're setting the pace this morning for the man of God who's coming at 10 o'clock. The church matters. And I hope you are at the place this morning to receive a blessing from the Lord.
The best I have, I will worship.
Angela Fleming, Carmelita Joseph Bailey, Evangelist Watt, Marlene Williams, William Thompson, good morning to you. Thank you so very much, church family. God bless you.
Lord, I worship you.
We worship you, God.
Rising
on the sun,
even twist. I lift my hand to your presence and I'm
morning to Wendy Potterfoot. Mae Smith, good morning to you. Maisie Jones, one love, sis. One love, mama. Christopher Rose, good morning to you. Come on in the room. Come on in the room, family. Come on in the room. I will worship you, oh God.
You are worthy of the best time.
Hallelujah.
We worship you.
We bless your name, Jesus. We worship you, Lord God, and we bless your name, Lord. For you are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy to the praise, to be praised, Lord God. All right. We're still waiting on the man of God to come through. So I'll just play some housekeeping music. Now listen up. If you got questions for the pastor, man, don't be afraid to text them to us. Text them to our number, 954-998-4777. Text your questions in. All right, and we will ask the pastor. Or you can email those questions to contact@gospellive365.com. We'll definitely ask those questions live on the air with our pastor. All right, so feel free to text me. Send me a text message with your questions for the pastor. I got 4 questions so far for him this morning, and these questions have been real good questions we've been getting, and so I'm looking forward to asking the pastor this morning his opinion on these matters, or what the scripture says, the Bible's opinion on this matter. All right, the Bible's opinion on this matter. I think he's walking through the door now. What a pastor. Good morning, sir.
Morning, you know, I'm going to have to start wearing some sneakers so I can tiptoe in. These shoes with heels are making too much noise.
It's so funny you said that, because we had a pastor just like that. You could hear him coming around the corner. And they used to say, Pastor, we'll hear you before we see you.
See, what we're talking about, church matters.
Yes, church, exactly. Ladies and gentlemen, we got our minister and pastor, Gifton Wallace, on the phone, and he's gonna be talking to us about church matters. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing pretty good in it. It's kind of good to be home. I'm farming, bonding again with mosquitoes. For a whole month, I didn't remember that there was anything called mosquito that existed.
What you saying?
But you know, they're really having a convention, wondering, asking me where I was. You know.
The mosquito.
They're telling me how I look foreignish. Because you know what, the mosquitoes, like those of you who stay away for a little while, you know, they ignore us when you all come.
Yeah, them smell foreign fire. My God. Them smell foreign, man. I saw the things.
Yes, man.
So,
but
Bishop.
It's good to be home. I mean, coming home into a lot of traffic, it took me actually almost an hour and a half more than what it normally would take to get home, because they are doing some serious road repairs in Jamaica. In fact, those who are familiar with Kingston and know anything about the 3 miles area, they're going to be having flyovers now. So when you come, you're not even going to know where you are.
Jesus.
So because of that, they have shut down the 3 miles area. Mm-hmm. And a lot of places, like this morning, I took my wife to work, and then we were coming on Constant Spring Road. One section temporarily is one way. So it is really just crazy. But if you know back roads,
back roads.
And especially the back roads that people don't know, and then the other part of it too, if you discipline yourself to get up 1 hour earlier and move out 1 hour earlier, avoid being in traffic for 3 hours.
Talk the things, Pastor.
So it's not going to change for you, so you have to change for it. That's exactly
Amen.
But outside of that, I'm doing pretty good. Somebody saying, Anthony is already asking, can I ask a question right here? That's the place he's asking that question. So send a question, Anthony. We will address that a little later. Let us just set the foundation, and then we take the questions. And one of the things, you know, when it comes to church matters, We are not afraid of any question.
No, because
one of the things that we desire to be is to relevant. And we will also say, too, that we don't have all the answers.
Right.
But we are going to try to be as transparent as is possible. And just like when you do Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, and Elder Gifton Wallace or DJ Bramwell don't have the answer, we just go to the lifeline and we ask the audience.
Yes,
because one of the things that we really want to do, as we spoke at the onset, is to allow this to be a learning experience.
Amen.
I don't come here as a lecturer.
Amen.
There
Amen.
Is nothing dictatorial
Amen.
About this.
No,
one of the reasons why we have made it very clear. It don't have anything to do with denomination. It don't have anything to do with any kind of religious belief. We come to speak to the church.
That's right.
And when we're talking about the church, we're talking about the body of Christ.
Uh-huh.
Those who have made a commitment to him. And it doesn't matter what your shade of interpretation is.
That's right.
Or what issue is not to frustrate that. And that is not even going to be entertained.
Mm-hmm.
We just come to talk to the body. I was in Connecticut on the weekend, and I spoke in a ladies' convention. Can you imagine the elder speaking in a ladies' convention? But, you know, sometimes the ladies need to hear from the perspective of a male.
Of a male, right.
Yes, man. So you ever tell them all the things?
No, wrong with that.
You understand? And we were talking about this woman, and I think I mentioned it some weeks ago, who was in church, and she was bent over for 18 years.
Amen.
And she went through the ropes.
Uh-huh.
But the woman had issues that only Jesus could address.
Yes, sir.
That is what we want to do, is to deal with some relevant issues. Leonie, my sister Leonie is watching, and Vicky is saying good morning. Vicky, you can't tell me morning alone. You have to tell DJ Bramwell good morning. You understand? You better tell him morning, you know.
You know what I'm saying? just mute the mic.
One of the things, and I'm going to say this from now so that we can begin to set the tone for next week. I'm going to talk about singleness next week, you know. I'm going to talk about if you're single, I want to mingle and them kind of a thing. But that's not the issue this morning.
Glory.
We just want to continue.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Glory. We're going to put on the roof.
Uh-huh.
We set the foundation.
Uh-huh.
We'll carry the thing up to bell course. We're going to put on the roof now.
Yes, man.
In terms of the foundation, and then next week we're going to talk about some critical thing.
Uh-huh.
So we'll deal with the singleness. Then we're going to roll and deal with the marriage thing.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to deal with parenting.
Yes,
we're going to deal with some people where they have to chat to them or you have to chat to them. That kind of a thing. Because all of these things are relevant.
Yes.
And they affect us as people.
Yes.
But this morning, one of the things that I really want to do is to talk about prayer. I mean, when we talk about prayer, some people right away might kind of join in the shell.
Mm-hmm.
You remember this thing that we call shame old lady. You touch it and it just lock up. We don't want anybody lock up yet. We don't reach right there, so. You understand?
Uh-huh.
We want to be able to talk about something that is relevant.
Uh-huh.
One of the things that came to me as I was prayerfully asking the Lord, you know, just to direct me with regards to how I speak to the body this morning, is that he talked about we have reduced church to be an entertainment facility.
Mm.
That's why we go to church on the Sabbath, or we go Sunday morning and come out and say church nice today, or even nice.
Uh-huh.
Because we have really gone there for entertainment.
Yeah.
I was reading something the other day, and it said something, and I'm paraphrasing now, to the effect that we don't just go to church for a message, but we go to receive a message so that we can be the message.
Mm.
Because there are some people who are not going to pick up the 66 books and read it, but you can't stop them from reading your life. They're going to tell us that the Bible is boring. They are going to tell you that they don't understand half that they read. And another set who is worldly wise is going to tell you that it's quote-unquote white man write it.
Mm-hmm.
And so they might, as a result of that, not gravitate towards the Word of God. But you cannot stop them from reading your life.
Amen.
And that is one of the reasons why the Word of God says, Paul told a group of people that you are our epistles, known and read of men. We are the biggest Bible award board. Whether we are 90 pounds or we are 250 pounds, we are big. Whether we are big deal Bible or we are meal deal Bible. You understand? But we are the Bible that people are going to read. And what we have done is to reduce church to an entertainment facility. Church nice today. Our church never nice today.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we have done is that we have missed God.
Uh-huh.
And as a result of that, we have compromised our relevance. And so we are not fulfilling our church mandate. When I came home, my wife and I were talking, and we were just talking about church. And I said to her that what we are doing is that we are doing church, but we're not doing ministry.
Mm.
Because the building, mm-hmm. really, you know, is the whole house, the facilitators of ministry. You know what is ministry? The little picnic will live next door to you. We don't have no shoes. Tear up. Or just have any khaki clothes. Or white squall are biting him hungry. I hope those in Canada can understand what white squall thing. Hunger to a level where your lips reveal the in terms of a texture, how what you feel on the inside, white squall, So we are not doing that, but what we are doing is church. Jesus did not come here to do church, you know.
That's right.
Came here to do ministry, and I want you. I never even thought about that until I just said, "Walk with me in the scriptures and look how many times Jesus went in the synagogue."
Wow.
Where is the Jesus? You see him in boats. You see him gone up on some mountain. You see him in some open field, that kind of a thing. Because Jesus did not come to do church. He came to do ministry.
Amen.
And I believe that as the body of Christ, we need to wake up and stop doing church and start the ministry. So guess what? Now, if my shoes don't match my pocketbook, and it's been have the Marley wig, you know, Marley curl and the president hair, and then something there. We can't go to church because that's what no. We have to sell off when we reach.
Sell off
because we have walked. Yeah, we have. Yeah, not now. We live after we do it. So our focus and our interest is church and not ministry, and so we're not fulfilling our ministry. So you know, and we're not gonna go back into what the church is. We understand that already. We established that already. But one of the things, because look at our services. We have youth Sabbath and men's Sabbath and ladies Sabbath and
men's
youth
Sunday
and ladies Sunday and men's Sunday and children Sunday and you have to wear your colors, you know.
Right.
Young people have to wear their colors and the choir uniform and stuff, and that becomes our focus. We have things like, and then sometimes to make it a little bit, and nothing is wrong with these. If it is structured, for us to grow and develop and to do ministry, it is welcome. Question is, Hebrew 4, how can I read this verse? All right. We'll come to that, and you might have to read the scriptures for me. All right. I think this morning, as I was thinking about the different Sundays that we have a thing like what we call African Sunday or African Sabbath. And the truth being told, the focus is that you should come dressed African. What is the motive behind that? Is it to create an awareness of ministry that is needed in Africa so that we can say, all right, we're going to pray for them, or we're going to find a way to enhance our ministry so we can, just like you are doing your streaming, we can stream to Africa, because one of the things about the gospel being spread enough in every nation, everybody can go.
Right.
But we can use the medium.
Right.
Like you are doing now.
Right.
That is available to us to do that. So when we have our African Sunday, it should be a focus. What can we do for Africa? How can we facilitate the meeting? But guess what? Now, it's on a fashion show. So it's like when we don't like Ruby. I'm going to make sure something other than Ruby. Ruby now more than me this Sabbath, and she now more than me tomorrow Sunday.
I don't know.
So we have lost our relevance. And we have lost our focus. And the truth, people, you know, DJ, you're going to have to pray for me after this, you know. But sometimes the things that the Lord just relax fully, and I'm just at bed with laugh after
me. Laugh after me.
Hear him now. Watch them in them African thing. And it is nothing about Africa. It is about their outfit.
Right.
And the hyping.
And the hot song. You ever sing the hot song, man?
We make sure our long African thing, hobble. Anyway, let me come off that before the ladies begin to shoot to Arab one. But we have really lost that. And so the question then comes, when we have all of these Sunday, like the youth Sunday and the women's Sunday or the youth Sabbath, when we have convention and we give them some nice name, you know, because my church now don't have convention anymore, you know. We have convocation. That's so nice he talks to.
It's so nice, yeah, man.
Convention to local.
Yeah.
We have convocation. And listen, we now have camp meetings. And we now having summits. And they call it, you know, one bag of nice name and no difference.
And no church.
We are in church, but we're not in a ministry.
Yeah.
One bag of nice name we are geek.
Yeah.
Camp meeting and summit. and convocation. But the question is,
yes,
when all of this is done,
mm-hmm,
are we challenged?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Are we empowered?
My God.
Are we educated to serve?
Mm.
Because Jesus' position and practice,
mm-hmm,
was one of servanthood.
Mm-hmm.
And that is where Martha McCall is saying, boy, it's true, Pastor, we are sure what we can wear.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? Right. Jesus' ministry was about servanthood.
Mm-hmm.
And we are more title-oriented and position-oriented,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
than we are concerned about serving. Hey, listen to me now, brother.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to, I will not wash our dirty little in the public.
Right.
We will not talk the things them as they say. Bad man running a church, you know, brother.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Bad man running a church.
Yes, man. Yes, man. Yes,
yeah, man. You have those who think that they have entitlement.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then there are those who just come and say, oh, how will just come?
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm,
gets to
and
be
reach,
into such position.
Yourself.
But you see, yes, one of the things that you must, when you read scriptures, you know, you recognize that as the Lord chooses people,
uh-huh,
you know, he still works with their personality. And for example, if there is somebody who is gifted in administrative skills,
mm-hmm,
and I am not, and I have been there for 30 and 40 years till Metcon Ratoon,
mm-hmm,
and somebody just come in with the skills, what should I do? Not make that person? Because what we should really do, you know, is to complement, complete,
mm-hmm,
and enhance each other.
Mm-hmm.
And in so doing, we're not just doing church, but we're doing ministry. And one of the things, Jesus, I mean, a little lady, you know, and I said that to you, I think it was last week or the week before. The week that I went to fast, we didn't know when we said what.
Listen, no, man.
But a little lady rolled up on Jesus and said she wants her son,
uh-huh,
to sit on the right and the other one on the left. And the man, them get bringled, you know.
Yes, man. You're vexed.
People got upset, mm-hmm, in church.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we are having that same kind of behavior and attitude. So that we are more title-oriented and we are prepared in some setting,
uh-huh,
to spend more money on certificates and plaques,
mm,
than we are on
Raven
ministry.
Come on now.
I want you, man. Everybody have a certificate on the wall.
Everybody.
And a
doctorate. And a doctorate something.
You,
uh-huh,
and you see all that now? That is a part of the politics of the church, you know.
And a doctorate,
because
something.
Because doctorate thing. Mm-hmm. Hello, there are some people. I mean, not sure nobody doctorate.
No.
But my problem with that is that we have so many doctors and the church still sick. Brother. Let me remember that I'm speaking.
Jesus.
We have so many doctors.
Come on, man. And the church still
is
sick.
Still sick.
Jesus.
Because one of the things I'm finding about, and I'm very grateful for how the Lord, the kind of ministry that the Lord has given to me, is a ministry mostly to people who are hurting.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, I have seen people leading us into worship, and by the time I preached to praise and worship leader, eyelash had dropped off because she had dead with crying.
Mm-hmm.
Because somewhere on the inside,
uh-huh,
they're,
uh-huh,
hurt.
Yes.
You understand? So
yes,
we have people going online and they're buy a little doctorate, 350 US and, mm-hmm, 200 US and 300.
Mm-hmm.
And hello. Dare, mm-hmm, you not address them by the title?
No, sir. Jesus.
Hello. Dare you not address them by
you
the
better,
title?
You better use that title,
Pastor so and so. And I'm gonna. I want to say something to all of my friends who in the spiritual medical fraternity.
Mm-hmm.
In a bad mind if I that correct, but listen to me. When you take on that title,
yes,
there has to be relevance,
mm-hmm,
because people are now looking to you,
mm-hmm,
to give something that is of a higher standard and a greater quality.
My God.
So you better do that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because once, mm-hmm, you come with the title, it simply means that you have committed yourself,
yes,
to the studying of the word,
mm-hmm,
to a particular level where you are now able to impart and dissect,
mm-hmm,
and exegese far above and beyond,
my God,
what those of us who are ordinary will be.
My, see, God,
you better rise up, you know.
That's right.
We are going to bring
that
the doctorate,
right,
into,
mm-hmm,
question. We're going to put it, mm-hmm, under a microscope. And listen, it's no shades here.
No.
And it's no bad mind here.
So hold you accountable.
So that is what it is. So what we do,
mm-hmm,
is that one of the things the Lord said to me this morning is that we need a church to revisit,
mm-hmm,
our relevance,
my
and
God,
our purpose.
My God. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Are we scratching where it itch?
Mm.
Are we meeting the needs of people?
Mm.
Are we meeting the needs of the wider community? Because there are some of us who are planted in communities and the communities don't know us.
Mm-hmm.
They only see us passing with a broad hat,
mm-hmm,
some of us like umbrellas and can't keep trees on the school under.
Jesus.
And we are concerned about how wide our hats are and how deep they are over our authority. But the community don't know us. So one of the things that he said to me this morning, we have to get back to the place where our church revisits our relevance and our purpose.
All right.
So to facilitate and reinforce that, God has provided one of the most beautiful outlets. And this is the outlet of prayer. I'm kind of checking my time here, man of God.
Yes, man. No problem, man. Go ahead. Good.
Yeah.
This is good.
So we need to begin to, as a church, revisit our relevance. Now, I started off by saying that we're going to be talking about prayer. And then I got into a lot of things because one of the things that I want to bring to our attention is that if we are going to exercise a certain kind of relevance, it is going to be relevant as God sees it. Because we have our own kind of relevance, you know.
My relevance
might be to make sure, say, my colors match.
Right. Right.
And my relevance might be to make sure somebody bad man you when you go up there.
Yes, yes.
So I'm talking about relevance as God sees it, or relevance to the scriptures. And one of the ways that we need to revisit, because we must understand that the church don't belong to us.
Amen.
And I said, like, I think it was the first or second setting that we had here, is that sometimes you see the spirit of nepotism. People are passing it down to them son, hand over the church to them son, and hand it over to them granny, and hand it over to them friend. Ooh. It's not ours to give.
Ouch.
It is not ours to give.
Hand on.
And the fact that it is, if you own a company, granted, you are going to have people like your HR people who you are going to trust to interview people. And if you're going to bring them in a managerial position, they are going to bring the person who is most suitable that can move the business forward. We must understand that the church is not our own.
But
God's church. I didn't buy it.
But Pastor, you have to keep the gift and legacy. You have to keep the gift and Wallace legacy. So your son have to be the pastor.
Because sometimes we promote some people to their incompetence, you know. We promote them to demonstrate how incompetent they are. And we have done them a disservice. You understand? And the church was not bought with a gift and blood.
That's right.
Gift and never go to Calvary.
That is right.
And the only cross I might come near to is if I wear a chain on my neck with one cross. Come and have a go for none. So it cannot be mine. And that's another show, you know, brother. About the maintaining of the gift and legacy, you know.
Yes, man.
Because while when we enter into ministry, when we talk about administration, we talk about this. It's always good to have people who have your back, because I'll tell you something. Sometimes as leaders, there are some people that are bad-minded still, and it would be to your detriment to put them in a place of promotion. For them to kill you and make you get great before time. But this is not the Easter faith. We just throw that in. You understand? But we must understand that the church belongs to God, and it is what he wants done. I distinctly remember saying, and I'm going to repeat myself, because one of the things they do in education is that they repeat for emphasis. I read the book. A lot of people knew the purpose-driven life. I don't know if you remember when that book did take Jamaica by storm. But I bought the purpose-driven life because I read a book from the same author called The Purpose-Driven Church. Rick Warren.
Yeah,
and in The Purpose-Driven Church, Rick says that many times as a church, we have our plans and we're asking God to bless it. How do we know that what we plan is what God wants to bless? And that thing hit me like a ton of brick. What Rick said is that what we should do is to ask God to help us to be a part of what he is blessing. Because let me tell you something, you know, if it is something that is not going to honor him,
right,
and that has no relevance to the kingdom,
right,
we could have jumped on 1 foot until tomorrow.
Bless it. Nah, bless that.
We could run and speak in a dozen tongues.
That's right.
Not going to move.
No.
Because at the end of the day, we must realize as a church, yeah, man, it is not what we want, it's what God wants. And may I ask a question? And this question requires a response. Can we genuinely say as a church that the things that we do from a week to week basis are the things that God wants? Do we ask for his direction? Do we ask him, Lord, what do you want to happen on Sabbath?
Jesus.
mm-hmm, or what mm-hmm. do you want to happen Sunday morning?
Mm-hmm.
I would just get up and say, you know, something, we're going to plan a program
mm-hmm.
and hope
right.
it works. And if it not work, we'll wheel and come again.
You hope it catch.
And if it work, we'll say the thing fell off. And take a little prayer to ourselves and still God glory.
Mm.
Because we are gifted at doing that, you know.
Now.
Yeah, man, take on what does not belong to us, take the Lord glory. So one of the things that we ought to do is, as we are told in Proverbs, that in all our ways,
mm-hmm.
we should acknowledge
him yeah.
and even direct our path. So God has created this outlet for us to pray. And I quickly want to say something about that. So that the prayer aspect is to facilitate and to reinforce mm-hmm. what God wants done.
Amen.
And when we talk about prayer, it's really talking to and listening to God. This morning when I was thinking about listening to God,
mm-hmm.
I grew up in an environment where I used to hear the older folks saying that they heard the voice of God. And as I youth, it kind of puzzled me because I'm saying, hear the voice of God.
Mm-hmm.
And people went as far as saying, I heard it loud.
Mm-hmm. Loud, I heard it loud
clear.
Speaking. Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. Voice of God speaking to me.
Uh-huh.
And that, you say, wow, that must be awesome. You know, but one of the things that we must understand is that you have to get past the stage where we just talk to God.
Right.
And not listen to him. And how you listen to God, for example, Sunday when I was preaching in Connecticut, there was a group that came over from New York. And when they came and I shared and we were in the hospitality room, they were saying, boy, Rev, it looked like you were in the car with us. Because all the things you were talking about, including the scriptures, except one particular scripture, were things that we were talking about. That is how God speaks to us. You might be kneeling down and you within your spirit,
mm-hmm.
you feel something.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe if you are like me,
mm-hmm.
who read after you pray, maybe through the scripture is how God chose to speak to you. But
My
we
God.
Have to recognize as a church that we have to give God, give the church back to God,
my God,
and then begin to ask him, what do we do and how do we move forward? That is one of the reasons, man of God,
mm-hmm.
that you have people down in church suffering from depression.
Mm-hmm.
You have people in there who are suffering from some serious sexual sins, all of which you went in, you know,
yes.
because we have enough
yes.
time, not today,
yes.
but on different occasions. You have people who are single parents who are not managing. You
yes.
have people who are married
mm-hmm.
and they are divorced in their minds,
mm-hmm.
living in the same house but in separate rooms,
mm-hmm.
sitting head and tail, not talking to each other, shop lock, the
mm-hmm.
food now cook, that kind of a thing. Those are some things that we are going to address.
Woo!
Because the church
mm-hmm.
does not ask God
mm.
to bring us to the place of relevance.
My God.
What we not seek
Jesus.
His intervention. We don't seek his direction. Because guess what? No. My certification
mm-hmm.
on the wall says
mm-hmm.
I have a diploma in theology
mm-hmm.
or I have a doctorate in divinity
mm-hmm.
or I have a master's in whatever. So we trust
mm-hmm.
whatever we are taught. And nothing is wrong with teaching because
no.
learning makes a man.
No.
And the Bible said that my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. So we embrace knowledge. We don't want to. But they say, Elder Wallace, bad mind.
Mm.
We don't work with a bad mind thing. We have to understand that there has to be a certain kind of a relevance. And when we ask God, God's direction, we are saying to him that my dependence is on you. Because I'm going to tell you something, brother man.
Yes.
Irrespective of how much we know,
uh-huh.
or whatever we experience,
uh-huh.
we can go so far and no further. We are limited
mm-hmm.
in scope
mm-hmm.
and knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why God never make one man get the inspiration to write the 66 book. You know, so God used different people.
Yes, yes.
Because one man don't know the thing. Can you imagine the trouble he would have been in if it was
right.
alone writing?
That's right.
Whoever alone writing.
Mm-hmm.
He would have been in trouble.
The Pope says.
That is what I'm saying.
The Pope says.
Yes. So. We have to get to the place
uh-huh.
where we begin to, as a church, ask God how to make us relevant. Because I cannot overemphasize this, brother man. We
uh-huh.
are not being
mm.
relevant
mm.
as a church.
Mm-hmm.
We are doing church,
mm.
but we are not attending to the matters.
Yes, yes.
And that is
yes,
why the Lord
yes,
gives
yes,
you the vision
yes.
about church matters.
Church matters, man. Oh,
because
my
we're doing
God.
The building
Jesus.
And we're doing the dressing and
yes.
we're adhering to the tradition
yes.
and we're repeating the creed.
Yes,
but we're
yes.
not doing ministry.
Mm.
We're not doing ministry.
Mm.
I was walking on the street last week in New York,
mm-hmm.
and I saw a young man
uh-huh.
smoking. And brother, we don't know why, you know,
mm.
but we just stopped. I said, mm-hmm. why are you doing that? I said, you're messing up your lungs. You're
mm-hmm.
damaging your own teeth.
Mm-hmm.
I said, what's your name? When the man tell me his name, Malachi, I said, do you understand the name? He said, don't say a word.
Oh, he said,
and
don't
right
say a word.
Away, I used it up. Yeah, man. Yeah, because he understand too.
Of course, of course.
Because he must know that he's a Bible name.
Uh-huh,
he must tell
uh-huh.
anybody that his mother or grandmother was a Christian.
He's
like a pretty name they gave him. They gave him a name with significance. And after I left, One of the things I regretted, though, is that I did not pray with him, because at that point he was open. Mm. But I just keep it moving because I was saying to myself, you know, I want to drown the man out within the ministry right here. So,
that's what
should happen
right.
every time we go to church.
Mm-hmm.
We should go there, receive, to go out and to offer.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not doing that, brother. We're in there, still don't have bad mind each other, and I criticize over eyelash long over one shot and over more actors here, right? Over for a titan who don't have right shape and who look attention from the pastor and who for vice never did pitch good by the praise and worship and who sing song where we don't like. That is what we have reduced church to.
Mm-hmm.
So we have not become relevant, and we are not affected, we are not attending to the matters.
Wow.
Of the church.
Yes, man.
And in that case, we are making the church not matter, especially to the outside.
Mm-hmm.
No church is perfect just as much as we are not perfect. But looking at ourselves, we are an individual. Let me see what Vicky is saying. Boy, Vicky, now leave me in a villa.
Vicky,
I can't read the rest of it. All right, I will see the rest of it, Vicky. But we're running in a question now because we're lost on time.
Amen.
But one of the things I want to say as I close this aspect of it is that we have to get to the place where we are ready, man.
Right.
And leaders have to transmit this to their followers, because sometimes it's a tail wagging the dog. Sometimes the people are at the bottom, they're leading the church, and the leaders are an eternal holiday. We have to transmit that to our people.
Jesus.
We have to transmit that to our people.
My God.
Any question, sir?
Oh, my God. Yes.
We do have a question.
Also,
we can't be preaching what the union says. What about what God says? Right about that. Yes, sir.
That is right. we have a couple of questions. We have a couple of questions that we from last week, because usually we go from the last week's question. But my brother, let's address his question since it's here on the floor, and I did save the question somewhere. So let me just get that question for you. The question he asked was, the question is in Hebrews 4 and verse 15. How can we relate this verse to our lives and how we minister to others? All right. So in the meantime, let me find the verse for you. Let me say Hebrews.
Hebrews, James.
Hebrews. 4.
Hebrews what?
15.
Hebrews 4 and 15.
Yes.
Let me see what. Hebrews 4 and verse 15. 15. I have it right here. The disciples of ours understand our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testing that we do and did not sin. And as a matter of fact, you know, I was praying for somebody who lost her sister, and it was very painful for her. And people tell people all kind of foolishness when they have lost loved ones, but they're not to cry and they must be strong. I tell her, you don't need to be strong, and you need to cry. Because one of the things that the Lord does is to give us our emotions. And I said it last week, the emotions must be utilized. If God gives tears, and don't give them for your soul, not a dam. God give your eyes so that the tears can come out. You must utilize it. And one of the things that, even in Hebrews, it points out that we have a high priest who is tempted as we are. And I want to qualify something here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want you to think that Christ has ever sinned, because he is the sinless, spotless Lamb of God.
Amen.
But he has gone through some emotional stuff like us. You know what it is to be rejected. In fact, before we came, that was said. John said he was despised and rejected of men. The Bible, Isaiah, let it known that he's not going to be embraced by people. So he understands that. He know what it is to be hungry. He was in the wilderness for 40 days.
Mm-hmm.
He know what it is for hell to tempt him to do things. But the beauty is that he did not respond in a negative or a sinful way. And we must also understand that while he was God, he was man. And just because he has gone through this, it qualifies him.
Mm-hmm.
Because, for example, I do a better job of counseling with someone who has lost their mother than someone who has never lost a parent. I've been there.
Come on, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So because Jesus has been there, he understands what we have gone through, and he knows how to really embrace us in that particular setting. I don't know if I've done justice to the question.
Amen. Well, if not, then he'll ask us further. Let's go to the question. Well, all right. There's one question on the website. Let me ask that one first. Pastor, why these churches are having a husband and wife, or wife and husband as pastor and co-pastor?
That has become a fashion. I'm going to make that very true.
Uh-huh.
That has become a fashion
uh-huh.
because we think that because we are involved in ministry, our wives should automatically have a title. But I tell you something about title too. The other day, a friend of mine was bothering me because my birthday is the 26th of this month, you know. Mm-hmm. So I had some friends in August, in October, who was saying that they want September done early. So I was kind of, you know, bothering one of them when she was trying to attack the good spirit month. Uh-huh. And she said to me, all right, first man. I said, you know, all I wanted to find out what I want because my wife pastors a church. When she comes to my church, they call her first lady. So when I go to her church, means what? No one would meet first man. but a lot of churches really does that. Uh-huh. They are pastors and they make their wives co-pastors. Mm-hmm. There are some wives who really has pastoral calling on them.
Amen.
My wife has a pastoral calling, and I'm not saying that because she's my wife.
Right.
I'm saying that because I'm aware of that calling. She's on her own. We pastor in two different congregations. Unfortunately, pastors are short in every organization.
Mm.
So instead of my wife being in my church, sitting down and looking pretty,
and we're in the pretty hat them.
Yeah, and listen to me now. And I don't have a problem with that because where she is being effective. Uh-huh. And I think she's being more effective than if she was where I was.
Mm.
Because she's actually reaping a harvest, as it were, for the kingdom. I was about to say, as it were, for herself. Mm-hmm. But it's not for
herself. No, it's not for her. Right. But,
so whereas if we were in one location, say, reaping 40 people for the year, and I am reaping 40 and she's reaping 40, I eat to that.
Yes, man. Yes, man. For one whole soul.
People do that. And another thing, too, that with regards to the website, I have gone into a setting where, I mean, nepotism stinks.
Mm.
The bishop is wife, his pastor,
yes, man.
His son is doing a minister.
Yes, man, doing a minister, an apostle.
Daughter is secretary, his friend, from in-law is
glory.
His administrator. Yeah, that's nepotism. And then that's everything what God wants us to do. We're looking for friends and family. And God will get the honor out of that.
All right, Angela, thank you so very much for that question. All right. Recently, a pastor in the States, right here in the States, husband, all right, and father of three young boys committed suicide. The question is this. If pastors are to be watching out for their congregation, who is watching out for the pastor in pain?
My God.
Mm-hmm.
When I read that thing, reached deep. And there was something I was reading, just scrolling through somebody to speak, and saw a young lady speaking for pastors' children. And the young lady was saying that speaking of pastors, really, she was saying that she really saw our father give his best.
Yes.
And how the church turned around and hurt him and stuff. A lot of people, some people tell me that they want to become pastors because they think pastors are a glamorous lifestyle. Some people think,
oh, Jesus.
And you don't envy them because you don't know the kind of sacrifice that people have made to come into what they now have.
Uh-huh.
And I am one that will tell you straight up that I believe in favor, and I believe that if God wants to favor an individual in a congregation and bless him with fleets, and I'm not saying that it should happen.
Right.
I'm just saying that I'm not in a position to be judgmental, and I will not do that.
Right.
If they're not looking out for the poor and the people of their congregation, no, we start to have a problem. But I believe that if God chooses to bless you, he can bless. The blessing of the Lord make it rich and add it no sorrow. I think that the people that we lead many times, and I'm saying we because I'm a pastor, so I'm going to repeat that.
Mm-hmm,
the people that we lead many times draw down on us, forgetting that we are human beings.
True.
We have a family. We have emotions.
Mm-hmm.
We have feelings. Because people can do things as a pastor. You know?
Yes,
and you must say, praise the Lord and speak in tongues.
Mm-hmm.
And take up the Bible and kiss it and walk off.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes you look like a good angel.
Yeah.
Hello,
yeah.
Please.
Yeah.
Blood
yeah.
is running in our veins just the same way. They can tell you what they want to tell you. But
that's
the minute
right.
you say something that they don't like, the thing comes. When I'm done, I'm saying, my pastor. It's unfortunate that we don't have anybody most times.
Mm-hmm.
Not all the times. Most times that we can bleed on. And the second part of it is that many of us have allowed people to pull us into a mold to make us think that we are superhumans. My name is Gifton Wallace.
Right.
I recognize I am Gifton Wallace. I am not going to try to be any other minister.
No.
You understand?
No.
If you saw me coming through the airport the other day, somebody buy one jeans, give me a decide something. No, that's for the jeans. Because you have now the jeans fit me like it make for me.
Mm-hmm.
You wear it, I'm my one.
Right.
And that don't affect my anointing. My anointing is not in my clothes.
That's
and
right.
It doesn't mean that I'm going to do anything and wear anything.
Right.
But I'm saying that pastors pass through stuff. They have struggles in their mind like everybody else. They have concerns for their children. Mm-hmm. But many times the church is not sensitive towards this. And I'm going to say this straight up, without any fear of successful contradiction and without any apology, a lot of churches do not treat their ministers well. A lot of churches see their ministers as targets for them to attack. We don't need that, because hell already have our names on hit list. Smite the shepherd and the sheep will go astray. And some people just badmind them pastors and speak bad of them in the evening, in the presence of their unsaved children and husband and wives. That's why they don't get saved, because you eat your pastor every Sabbath or every Sunday. As soon as you reach home.
My God.
Jesus. So we have issues too as human beings. And that's one of the things that our churches must recognize, is that there is a humanness to us. We never drop from sky into the ministry.
Amen. Amen.
We come through the ranks with the pants like everybody else.
Right. Right. One foot at a time. Foot at a time. Listen, Pastor. Listen. Pastors sometimes get grief from their members, right? If they take time off and are unavailable and absent from church for a month or a few weeks annually. How vitally important is it, right, for a pastor to take vacations as they seek to remain effective in serving God's flock?
Watch Jesus' ministry. You know, say Jesus take for himself every now and again.
Every now and again, him gone, you know.
Yes, man, and some little bad man people still around him don't feed milk him. We need to do that. I just came back. Today is the 12th.
Yes.
Today marks 1 month. Would have marked 1 month
since you left.
2 days ago. Since I left.
Jesus.
And I called my church and I told them, listen, I need 6 weeks. Because if I leave and systems are not in place and people can't evolve, I have not fulfilled my mandate as a pastor.
Wow.
Because if you can't build people behind you, you are ineffective and irrelevant, and you are a non-entity. Need to go sell some bad juice. We're not discriminating against the sale of bad juice. But you must be able to raise people, put structures in place that you can go. There are some pastors who are behaving like they are made with claws, and they have their claws on the church. You can't start unless them walk in.
Yes. Pastor's not here yet.
You can't put my business. Sorry. I will take my break. Yeah, man, at 17, I will look fresh same way.
That is, there you go. You know, the funny thing, I was saying that to someone, that from when I was a young boy and I used to see you walk past the church that I attended in Jamaica, you look the same way today. Because I was looking at the picture you sent me the other day, the picture we have on Facebook. You look the same way, my youth.
No, and then, my maid swell up and me have a couple
of people. No. I'm being so serious. Yeah, we get like a gray hair here and there, and that's fine. I'm talking about our features. It's just the same.
Man of God.
Yes.
Man of God, I have learned to take care of myself. I'm going to tell everybody, send me now, mash up my summer body. Hello.
Save him, Jesus.
Thank you very much, Vicky. Vicky said I look very young. Thank you, Vicky. And next week after next, this time, it's gonna be 54 years I'm on planet.
Wow.
Thank God for
God
that.
Bless, man. God bless you, sir. God bless you.
Yes, sir.
We'll have your party right here at Gospel Live 365, okay? But listen, I got a couple more questions for you. Some mega churches, and I don't like the mega churches idea, where we point them out, but some churches, let me leave it at that, some churches don't make provision for after church needs, all right? For after church needs. People have nowhere to go to get things off their heart or have any contact with pastor, since he's surrounded by his quote-unquote bodyguards, you know, the senior ushers and senior this and senior that, bodyguards with earpieces. Is this necessary or appropriate for God's house, since pastors have such a huge responsibility for God's people?
Let me tell you something about mega church. I would like to have a mega church. And let me tell you why. But if you do have a large following, it simply means that you're doing something right. Simply means you're doing something right.
Right.
You understand? And somebody might take me to task on that and say maybe that they're doing a lot of things wrong. Why some people following? Because a lot of people are not following after holiness and following after crowd.
Right.
But
right.
I think if you notice, even from Old Testament, you're not going to get away from crowd. You're not going to get away from the reality of not being able to have a one-on-one with your leader. Moses sat down from morning till night to judge the people. And his father-in-law, who wasn't called by God, said, no, you can't do that. Set people over different aspects. The same thing happened in Acts when they start to quarrel about the fish and bread that never served good and who will look out for them family, like when you go to some family wedding. You understand? Paul said, listen, we can't serve the word of God. We can't leave the word of God to serve people. So that is how deacons came about. Get seven men, honest report, that kind of a thing.
Right.
Where if we have mega churches and they are structured properly, they can be effective. Not everybody can see the pastor. And one of the things that we have to do is to understand that if you are a member of a mega church, that's your choice. The church can't change for you. That's your choice.
That is right.
If you want a church where there's an open door policy, you have to go to that church.
Yeah,
but if you go to a mega church, that is your choice.
Right.
So don't stand there and fume and pout.
And complain.
because the truth being told, it comes back to what we say, the humanness of the pastor.
Yes. So
a pastor
true.
Cannot see
so
2,000
true.
People in a week. You know, right, in a fear. Who wouldn't have any time to have certain kind of
that's
worship
right.
and fellowship with his wife?
And his family.
Spend time with his kids. That kind of a thing.
Gotcha.
And to do the administrative work so people are put in place. That's why we need competent people
and accountable
in church.
Accountability, man.
Yes, we are going to be able to take care of the ministry. Because the pastor's responsibility is an axe, you know. To really to give themselves over to the word and pray, you know.
Amen now. Amen.
And we are involved in deep administrative work, and it affects sometimes, you know, how we dispense the word because
right.
we take on too much.
Wow. That. That's powerful. That's powerful, right? I was having that conversation with my mom over the summer.
A lot of these churches set up what they call like cell groups. So like if you're a single parent, they will have, or if you're somebody who was involved in drugs,
right?
Or if you're somebody who is suffering from any kind of anything, maybe mental disorder, because that mental situation in church, mental disease is not necessarily that you're mad.
Right.
You might have some kind of issue that is hereditary. But some of these churches set up structures so that your immediate need can be catered to in a smaller group. Because it would be better when you are in small groups, you know. Because sometimes when you're in the big old group, it's not really
true,
like you.
True.
And it creates an atmosphere for you to hide and not to be transparent.
Right.
You know, so they have some of these things in place.
The small cells group give more transparency. That's right. Speaking about fish and bread. Speaking about fish and bread ministry, my mom used to talk a lot about fish and bread ministry, and you just mentioned it.
I'm looking at her name right now at these feet.
Where it's not enough to just say we'll be praying for you, all right? Somebody call and them have them situation. Oh, we'll be praying for you, my sister. But rather, we need to go a step further in putting bread in their bellies. What's your take on the church's role in meeting the real needs of its community? Food banks, and that's exactly what we're talking about today. Food banks, prayer, gift cards, or as appropriate, whatever it is. Should pastors include such things in their annual budget?
It should. It should. And let me tell you something. Annual budget is a big word. Because there are some people who neither have annual nor the budget.
Right.
Because fortunately, some ministries have people who don't understand the importance of giving to the ministry.
Wow.
Because I'm going to tell you, you see that nice thing you have over your head there? And the nice microphone and all, and the nice thing you have there.
Money.
You didn't walk into somewhere and to praise the Lord and get them free.
No.
Did you have to pay for them, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
and we don't understand that. And this is where some people went to probably throw a stone. And not me, you then wear lickies, you them see. So you go and get the lick. Some of us don't graduate from a $50 offering. I'm talking about Jamaican dollars now. I'm not talking about US dollar offering.
Right.
Let me come into America. When I graduate from George Washington, the dollar them come church now. The $50 them come church here now.
Mm-hmm.
I came back to Jamaica and I bought $3,000 worth of gas and it didn't go past my quarter tank.
Mm.
And I said, well, now what happened here? Because I didn't look at the gas price.
Uh-huh.
It's almost $160 a liter for gas.
Jesus. Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
So, and I can't drive the car without gas.
That is right.
The church can't function without money.
That is right.
I can't get the gas without money.
Amen.
What's who going to pay for the light bill? Who going to buy the gift card? Where are we going to get the money from?
Right.
Because there are some people who have the notion that pastor is rich and he should do it or she should do it. But that's a part of ministry.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that a number of persons that we are leading are sensitive to understand that we become effective when we do these things. But it is going to take finances. You cannot speak in tongues and go down to Mega Mart or public supermarket and ask them to give you things.
Mm.
You have to have money to buy it. Where is the money going to come from?
That's right.
So the people that we, and then I'm going to tell you something, another part of it too. While we serve the community, there are some people in the community who don't believe that they should even give to the church when they're in a position to. But they think the church will give everything to them. That's the focus, you know.
Right.
So we pay tax to go. I mean, can't look after us, give people things free because they have the tax to double with. But if we don't give, we can't be effective.
Wow. So true, sir.
But I believe that whether we're it, the other part of it too, man of God, is that we can find ways to do it. For example, if the church is not in a position to take care of certain needs, those of us who see some needs and we personally are in a position to minister to those needs, minister to it. When your children quote unquote pass the words and stop going to school, and they are now helping to support you, and you are in a position financially, okay? Send out to middle school a week time, man.
Right.
That's
right.
Another way of doing it, you know.
Yes, sir.
Instead of waiting for the church as an entity to do that.
And a lot of people, and I've seen this, a lot of people sometimes in church, they'll say, they saw that this person have a need, and you know, they're not coming with a plan. They're just coming to tell the church. They're coming to report the need that the person has. And don't come with a plan. And sometimes as church members, and I'm included, as a church member, sometimes you should have a plan. You understand what I'm saying? You met the person and the person have a need. You have a plan and come to pastor with a plan and say, pastor, you know what? I met someone with a need, you know. And, you know, this is the situation. And explain the situation. And they come with a plan. Come with something in mind. It's like you're always expecting that pastor should always have a plan and the church should always have an idea ready for this situation and that situation. Yes, and we might have used that idea just yesterday. You understand what I'm saying? The church idea, you know, might have been used yesterday. So you come with a plan and say, you know what, pastor, I fed her for the last 2 days and I'm going to need help for the third. You understand what I'm saying to you? So we come with this thing where we bring everybody's situation to the church, and we as individuals, we as church members, don't even have a plan to, you know, you can't help at all. Did you eat yesterday? Yes, you did. So, you could have shared some of your thing with her and then, you know, come to us and say,
one of the other things I want to talk about, especially with regards to our counterparts who are abroad,
yes,
the America, the Canada, the England, a lot of times people want to help.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes there's a kind of disrespect in the health.
Right.
I have had barrels coming to me, and when we go to the
rock
main bar, people, it's like some things that people just fling out.
Yeah, uh-huh.
They see that's what they must keep the people. Are
it expired?
If it is not something that is good enough for me, it's not good enough for you, and you must stop it.
Yes.
Because while we know
that is right,
everybody has things challenging. I travel a lot. I mean, no, so foreign is not what some people make it out to be. There are some people who do not bus fare to go back, but please, man, if you're going to do something for the church, we till the July 4th sale or wherever, and we get something that is good.
I'm Black
Friday. There are things, for example, you wore this wonderful size 8, and you shall pass this way about once, you're not 8 anymore.
Right.
You've gone up to a 10 or a 12, but you have some nice things. Don't sit down and admire them and turn them. turn them into monument.
Exactly.
That's what I'm saying.
Buy one, get one free.
So you want to bless somebody.
Yeah, buy one, get one free. So you buy one and give away the free one. But we'll buy the...
You use them
we'll buy one, get one free, and we'll keep the other one. Buy one, get one free, and we'll still keep the other one. Come on, just give up the other one. That's okay. You understand what I'm saying?
Yep.
Pastor, thank you so very much for coming on this morning. Church matters, people of God. Jesus, church matters. Church matters. Thank you, sir. And
I would have wanted to continue to pray so that the church will matter.
That's
what I've just seen as a monumental structure. Father, we thank you for your continued faithfulness and your blessings on our lives.
Yes,
we pray that you will help us, Lord, to continue to be relevant. And even as we speak to the needs of the church, we recognize that there are those, Lord, who has more than a spiritual need. As a matter of fact, Lord, many of them are unresponsive to the spiritual aspect of the church because they're the socioeconomic aspect of their lives that becomes their greatest challenge.
Jesus.
Make us open and sensitive and responsive as a church
so
that we will meet people where they are. And we will become relevant. Continue to speak to the hearts of your people, for we give you praise. Bless your man servant and those who are listening, and even those who are listening and are broken or have needs. You promise that you will supply according to your riches in glory, and we choose to believe your report.
My God.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Thank you once again, sir. And I'm asking those of you who are on Facebook, I'm asking you to join us on our website shortly because the man of God is gone and we are going to be gone on Facebook also. So join us on the website, Family of God, all right? Pastor, next week, same time. God's willing.
Gospel Live 365 presents Church Matters with Pastor Gifton Wallace each and every Wednesday morning at 10 Eastern. Listen in as Pastor Gifton discusses matters and issues of the church and gives us spiritual guidance and leadership in correcting them. Bring your questions by calling or texting our studio at 954-998-4777. That's 954-998-4777. You don't want to miss Church Matters with Pastor Gifton on Wednesdays at 10 a.m. on your all-day, all-night station, Gospel Live 365 Radio.
Indeed, indeed, indeed. Church do matters, y'all. Church do matters, man. And I want to thank every single one of you on Facebook, or one of you on the website this morning. Thank you so very much for joining us. Now, I'm encouraging you, please go on our website for the continuation of the Gospel Joy Morning Show, all right?
Gospel Joy with DJ
Patricia Bowen.
Gospel Live 365 Radio.
Wondering when your night will be gone. You've cried and prayed, still you can't see your way. You've done all God said to do, serve in spirit and in truth, yet still you ask, oh, when will God come through? But I've got a message for you. God delay, just not me, deny all. Remember God delivered Daniel from those liars.
to the website, family of God. Come on over to the website, www.gospellive365.com/chat-live. Come on over. My God. What a lesson this morning. Church matters with Pastor Gifton Wallace this morning. Thank you so very much, sir. God bless you. God bless you. Each and every Wednesday at 10 o'clock. Each and every Wednesday at 10 o'clock, we hear from the man of God. Say good morning to Alicia Cole, who is the designer of my t-shirt this morning. Alicia Cole, I love my t-shirts, girl. Blessings to you. Hallelujah. Patricia Bowen, God's delay is not denial. It's 11 o'clock. Come on over to the website so we can continue having church, y'all. Once more, come on over to the website. God bless you. Facebook, we love you. All right, all right, all right, all right, all right.